sort of MOs in here. Like, some people are more interested in scalping, some people are more interested in the long term. So hopefully you can find something that will be useful for you. So let's get started. From your chamber. Normally would not take that long to load. Don't know what that is. All right, so bar to bar. Bar to bar is a relatively simple complex, or concept, I should say, excuse me. It's only looking at the relationship of the last two bars to determine a price sequence. Human, so the main purpose for this indicator is to clean up price action number one, in as much that you know that these bars have really no contextual relationship to one another, whereas the ones with the arrows do. So this I would label a bar to bar up, this I would label bar to bar down. One of the first thoughts that I had around this indicator, as far as why I like it, is that it's pretty much a math certainty, which is rare in a market, but it's a mathematical certainty that any trend of any direction that manifests in the future has to start with a bar to bar in that given direction. So I would argue it's not even possible for this uptrend to begin without at least a bar to bar up first, just like it's not possible for this downtrend to begin with at least a bar to bar down. You know, there has to be one of those first. So I wouldn't look at it like short here, long here, short here, long here. That's not a correct approach. What you're looking at is sort of an application of odds and relationships. So right here, if this was the future we were looking at, you would say there is no relationship on this daily time frame of price going up yet. So we would need new data to assert that there was in fact a chance of an uptrend like this. And then you move over one bar and you say there is no relationship yet that shows that an uptrend is about to start, because we know that an uptrend has to begin with one of these bar to bar ups. And then you come over and you say there is no data that suggests this relationship, on and on. Now, of course, when you get the first one, it doesn't mean that an uptrend is going to happen. But now you know that there is an actual difference in the probability and the relationship from here to here. So you can, you know, frame your thoughts accordingly. And then what happens? Well, we don't get any follow through. So you say, well, look, we had one. Maybe we'll get another one. We'll see. And you get another one down. So now you can flip the script and say, well, gee, if in fact we're going to get another move down, it has to start with this bar, because this is a bar to bar down. And then you say, oh, look, we get a bar to bar up. Well, now the relationship has changed again. So that's why it's not so much useful for trading, like buy, sell, but helping understand how the relationships are developing, it can help identify marking a low. So if, in fact, you thought that this was a tradable low, it would be more, you know, even though price is lower down here, in my mindset, it's better to start looking for some up action after this bar. But, you know, you can overlap this with better timing techniques like a moving average or whatever it is you like to determine if that's a good entry or not, because, again, that's sort of outside of the purview of what this is trying to show. It's trying to help you identify the relationships between the bars, so that way you can sort of make an odds-based assessment of why this bar is different from this bar and why this bar is different from the prior bar, you know, in case you don't see that. So that's, you know, real kind of like not trading strategy, right? But helping you visualize price behavior. And the reason why I like it also is that it cleans up the data a little bit. It's almost like a slightly improved version of just open, high, low, close, in that, you know, this is obviously a negative day and it's got the arrow. Well, this was a negative open to close day too, but there's no relationship, so it's less important. A more...
Can you elaborate on the relationship here?
Yeah, the relationship is just sequencing these last two bars based on, you know, maybe like...
Which last two?
The current one and the one that it touches. So this one is the relationship of this bar to this bar. And, you know, let's say this one is the relationship of this bar to this bar. That's it. So if you were looking at it like any sort of indicator that has a look-back period, the look-back is set to 2. So it's a very near-term relationship. That's why I call it B2B, which is bar to bar. So it's a bar to bar relationship. And one of the ways that you could use this practically for trading, as opposed to just looking at the triangles, is if you have a strong trend, then usually what can happen is you can trade around the bar to bars as a, buy the dip type of mentality. So just to cherry pick some examples, you know, if this was constituted as a strong trend, you have down, 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 and here we have a bar to bar up. Well, the next bar to bar down could be an entry for a move lower, because it's sort of like this is the retrace that you fade, if that yeah. makes sense. And, you know, you can, like, the more and more you can see this, there's examples where, you know, if we just sort of go through this, here you had 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2 up. Here was the first one down. So that could be the entry based on this being the retrace and this whole thing being the trend. Same thing yeah. here. You've got, you know, a bunch down. Here's one up. Then this is the entry because it's the first one that is in the direction of the original trend after you had the retrace.
Yeah.
And likewise, here you get up, you get up, you get up, you get up. You don't ever get a down on this one. By the time you finally start to get some downs by the same logic, you would want to get long here. Well, you know that trade didn't work out. Maybe you see this kind of mix mash and then down and you go, you know what, I think price is going down again. You get an up, you trade the next down, you get a slight leg lower. So keeping in mind that this is bar to bar, as in it's a look-back period of two, understandably the trades are going to be quick. Like seeing this short and getting, you know, 100 points out of it is probably not the norm, but for a sort of like a quick scalper type of entry or a mean reversion type of entry, I do think there's utility there. And now you can see we've had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 bar to bar up. Here's our first bar to bar down. So just to recap, what does this tell us? This tells us that if, in fact, we're going to have a decline, it should start with this bar. This would be bar one. But it also tells us these last two bars have had no relationship to really anything. And it also tells us that if this is the equivalent of, you know, one of these trades, if we get a bar to bar up over here, that is most likely a good long entry, because generally speaking, that would be, this would be the dip in the trend, is what that would argue. If we get another bar to bar down, another bar to bar down, then you say, okay, well, the relationship is changing. So this is very simple, and this isn't,
can you, explain what the definition is of there being a relationship between the current bar and the previous bar and not?
Essentially, what I'm looking for a pattern of open, high, low, close that defines the relationship. So when you, if you go back in time and you just pick random spots and you know, I encourage you to test the theory that 100% of trends will begin with the bar to bar, because I've tested that theory and it's held pretty well true. It's just looking at that there has to be some sort of, here, let me do this. There has to be some kind of relationship between, why these are arrows, price, that ultimately, the way I design these indicators, let me say, is by looking in hindsight for everything. So I would look at this type of chart and I would say, you know, in hindsight, I would want to sell up here. And in hindsight, maybe I'd want to buy down here. And in hindsight, I would want to sell right here and I'd want to buy down here and so on and so forth. So once I had figured out what I wanted to do in hindsight, I asked, what is the relationship between this bar and this bar? What is the relationship between this bar and this bar? And so on and so forth. And I basically just made a map and I mapped all the relationships. So I'd have 5 or 8 relationships that look like they correctly identified this bar or this spot or whatever. And then I went through and did a best fit. So I said, okay, we're looking at Bitcoin daily. Well, what if we look at ExxonMobil on a 5-minute chart? Well, where do the relationships come and go on that chart? Does it still hold true? What if I jump to, you know, the euro on a weekly chart, on and on? So I did this, you know, 1,000 times or so until I had found what I had determined to be the best fit fingerprint. So once I had the best fingerprint, then that was essentially what I programmed in. So that you can't really get everything you want to look at in one, which is why some of these indicators overlap and some are totally separate. So the bar to bar is just one way of helping me price action. I used to have a rule where if you had a bar to bar up after a decline and then another bar to bar up after it, that was a good reversal entry. I don't really use that rule as much anymore because I think I've developed a better way of determining that with the confirmed reversals. But that would be, you know, one of the ways that you can sort of play around with this. Like if you go to, obviously certain instruments are going to trade differently than others, sometimes the signals are, you know, extremely accurate, and occasionally, especially on some time frames in 4X, because 4X tends to be a lot more range-bound, then it can get more challenging to get meat out of the trade. Like, maybe the pivot comes in the right spot, but, you know, it doesn't really move enough to make it tradable for me. So I look at that as, like, not the best, you know, application. The whole thing was originally designed around equities, which certainly have, you know, supply-demand imbalance that will lead to given to trends. But, you know, if you look at, like, the opportunity for scalping or swing trading with just the bar-to-bar, big trend, small decline, first bar-to-bar up, there's a little scalp opportunity, you know, so on and so forth. So I think that you can develop entry and exit rules around this. It is not a formalized system with the bar-to-bar. But, you know,
does it count as a signal when you see two arrows in the same direction, or is one arrow in that?
Any arrow, any direction, at any context is telling you that there's the relationship there. So a little bit you can create the inference. Like right here, there's no arrows. So when we get this first bar-to-bar down, you can say, look, I know that all future declines of any magnitude, whether it's this or this, begin with a bar-to-bar down. That's the theory here. So by seeing this, I know that the relationship has changed from here. Here you could argue prices, you know, if we're talking about units, X unit bull or bear, here it has to be a greater unit bear because of this. And then when you get another one, you could say, well, the relationship is getting stronger, so maybe here's 1, 2, and we resume our uptrend, or maybe here's 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, 5, 6, 7.
Yeah.
So it's helping you map out. It's not incredibly predictive, like this means more decline. It's just telling you what the relationship is. So it's really more of a descriptive. It's a descriptive and not a predictive statistic, but it helps you see the difference. Like, why is this bar not bearish versus why is this bar bearish?
Yeah.
And then likewise, when you get that bar, you can say, well, geez, I know that all uptrends, whether it's this down here or whether it's just this right here, begin with a bar-to-bar up. So what this does is it changes this relationship. And while someone else might be doing something like this, you know, which is fine, this can help you sort of marry that concept. So if that's something you're already looking at, you're like, well, here's the support, here's the breakout. You can overlap that by saying, well, now we've got some reason that the sequence is up.
Human left your and, chamber.
You know,
yeah.
It can... What I encourage everyone is rather than say this is his methodology, I'm going to apply his methodology, by all means, you should take the concepts that I present and try and marry them with your existing approach. So if you are a firm believer in some method of trading, you could care less about support and resistance, but you're a big user of just trends, then there are ways to make this approach useful for you. Say, you know what, I'll scalp one bar, I'll scalp inside of one bar, and that to me is a good way to trade, then there's a use for you. So in designing this software, I made it for me. I made it to solve a problem that I was having and to make my analysis better. But when I approach clients about it, it's not a very conducive, you know, approach to say, I know more than you, you should listen to what I say and abandon your approach for what I think is better. What I think is much better is to say, you probably have tons of great ideas that I've never even conceived of. Let's see if some of my ideas can improve your ideas. So remember that, and that the relationships of the bar to bars, they are what they are. But if you happen to see a particular pattern, then by all means, please use that pattern. So one more that I'll throw out there is you only get so many of these in a row. I have another indicator that counts the count. So here you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then you get 2 up. What I've noticed is that typically you get between 4 and 7, let's say 4 and 8 to suit this example, before you get something in the other direction. So without looking at what Apple does next, here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Some people might say, well, look, that's clearly overbought. But you can also say on a bar-to-bar basis that you'd expect at least 1 or 2 down at this point. So for someone else who might be saying, oh, look at this little range breakout, you might say, well, you know, I don't know if that's the best entry at this point. There might be a lower risk entry, especially if we can get a bar-to-bar down and then trade the next bar-to-bar up as part of that buy-the-dip strategy. So let's see if that holds any merit. So there was our bar-to-bar down. That was enough to interrupt the chain, and then this already could be a buy the dip for bar to bar up. And, you know, there's a bar to bar down. Let's see if we can buy another bar to bar up. Up, now we got three, so getting a little more skewed. There's a bar to bar up. You could have bought that, and, you know, maybe you got stopped out. But as you see, the relationship is, you know, hard to, like, trade on two bars and say the relationship is going to extend for five or six bars. The main thing that I think it can be useful for is simply just keeping track of the relationship from here to here, rather than necessarily predicting. So that's the bar to bar. It's definitely the simplest concept. It's just here and here, here and here, and helps you form the relationship. And there's things I haven't explored. Like, I'm sure if you did multi-time frame analysis, weekly, daily, 60-minute, and could get some bar to bar overlaps, that would provide more use than looking at it in a vacuum like this.
Yeah.
That's that.
I think you're overestimating my competence level. I'm a total noob, and some of the things you're saying are like, whoa, I never thought of that. Like, I need to up my game.
Like, well, then I guess that's a good thing too. I mean, I've been trading for a long time, so sort of some of this, if I'm talking in a specific terminology or a way of thinking that isn't totally clear, then definitely just interrupt and I can clarify, because there's a couple things that go on. There's a lot of temptation to just be guessing the future. Me guessing the future has almost no bearing on actual trading or even the results, because I want to look at everything in terms of a risk-reward relationship. So that's why I'm so big on relationships. It's not like that buying here is better than buying here if you can find an acceptable risk-reward reason for that relationship. So when you look at analysis and trading and trying to make better trades, there certainly is a overlap there. You want to have good analysis and make good trades in conjunction. But really what you're doing is you're playing a numbers game. So even if you have terrible analysis and you have no idea what you're talking about, if the structure of your trades is skewed positive, then even with your blind, you know, dart throwing, you'll do better than someone who has great analysis but poor trade structure. So it's really just one piece of the puzzle. And sort of as like an aside, no one has asked me this personally, but I know it's kind of a common, you know, idea. It's like, well, if this is so great, then why are you selling it? And I say, well, this is exactly why I'm selling it, because it's an important part of the puzzle, but it's not the complete puzzle. You still have to apply position management, risk management. This just helps you form a strategy, which is where a lot of people are also in the dark. I think the risk management part is actually fairly simple once you figure out what you should be doing, and then you find a strategy and you overlap the two, and that is much closer to developing a successful setup and trade structure that lasts, rather than, you know, oh, well, I see this and I see that, and well, this is happening, so I'm going to do this. And that type of trading, in my opinion, is not viable. It may be short-term viable, but it is not long-term viable. So, I guess that might have been a little bit off topic to your question, but when I look at the relationships, I'm really much more concerned about how my risk is and what the relationship is than just simply predicting, if that makes sense.
I think that part of the question too might be here, is there some type of legend that we can refer to that will clearly delineate what all these different signals mean, what all the various signals and symbols that you've annotated the candles mean. I think that would be super useful for a lot of folks.
Yeah, definitely. I do have some brief documentation on my website. It is not complete. You'd be surprised how difficult it is.
I tried accessing that documentation, and it didn't work.
You want to hear something funny about that? In the 1 week since I put it up, Google changed the syntax for embedding documents from Google Drive. So it broke
it. What, you kidding?
I'm not.
Oh my God, they would never
joking.
Do that.
I know, I'm not joking. So if you go there now, I fixed it, but that was a major what the fuck moment for me.
I just bought your thing on TradingView.
Oh, nice. Let me see who this is. Who was that just did that?
It's Anton, I think.
Anton.
Yeah, Anton. All right, great. Well, thank you. I appreciate, you know, your interest. And basically, here's what I tell every person, which I'm sure some of you can attest to. when you sign up, I send you a little note, which A, thanks you, you know, for your patronage, and B, my number one goal is that this helps you and it makes a material improvement. But my number two goal, which is just as important to me, is to provide good customer service, you know, better service than the next person is going to get. So please always feel free to PM me, email me, ask me any question, and I'll do my best, because even if you decided, you know what, this isn't for me for whatever reason, I don't ever want you to say in the future, oh, and the service was shitty too. It's one thing if people like this more or less, and so far the feedback has been very positive, but I want everyone to know that I want each person who especially is, you know, giving their time and their money to prove to me, I want to know that that's reciprocated and that I want you to succeed, get some insight, more so than just this is providing or the stochastics or whatever. So that's my little blurb for you, Anton, is I appreciate it and always feel free to contact me with anything so I can help you get the most out of it.
Thank you, bro. Much appreciated.
Yeah.
Hey, right on, Spider Crusher. Hey, I have a question for you, too. Actually, I purchased your indicators, too. And one of them, you actually had me tweak some levels yesterday. It was the SCMR dynamic levels.
Yeah.
Your documentation says to tweak the levels to five times whatever the period is that you're looking at. On one of your charts, I noticed that you had laid down 3 dynamic level indicators and it set them up, what was it, like 30, 60, 120 or something, 30, 69? I can't remember, but it was different, so I'm wondering about that.
Sure. Well, I guess let's just go right to there then. You see that you can sort of do incomplete notation and bring it up if that's faster for you. And you hit backslash on the keyboard to get to this indicators dialog. That's another trick. So the dynamic levels, essentially, it's a gift and a curse that you have to change it because you'll notice the other indicators are automatic. The gift is that you get the flexibility. The curse is that you have to actually go in and manually change it each time. So I think that's the best compromise because now you can pick whatever you want. So when you draw support or resistance, typically, what they, you know, sort of the textbook definition, let's say, is basically you're playing a game of connect the dots. You go, well, here's a dot, here's a dot, here's a dot. I'm going to connect the dots. And this must be resistance and
human in your chamber is recording.
whatever the inference is. I think that there's a better approach to that, which is rather than connect all these dots, why not look at the actual level that provided the greatest supply-demand imbalance and say that that is the support or that is the resistance? Because that's the entire concept, is that there's a certain level where the imbalance is such that price moves away from that level. Well, I don't really care so much that it's here, 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 and here. I want to know which one is the best one to use. And the other thing I see people do that really bugs me is they'll do something like this, because they'll say, oh, well, these were the lowest lows in this set, but there's no way you can know that at the time that this was the lowest low in the set, right? So I hate when people draw trend lines and they skip peaks. Like, you should draw the two nearest to each other, and that's it. That is your trend line. So as you can
right,
see,
right, there's a mean trend. There's a mean angle there that is created when you connect those dots.
Right.
It's not necessarily flat.
So what ends up happening is that the trend line will constantly be changing if you're looking at the two nearest peaks and troughs or whatever. And that, to me, is also confusing.
Quick question, right? When I turned it on in TradingView, the whole chart shifted up and it got really small.
Yeah, what you want to do is you want to right-click the price scale and do scale price chart only. That will solve that problem. Essentially, what is happening is, like, if you were to add a moving average, and, you know, let's just say you make this, like, 3,000 periods or something, the moving average disappeared. You'll notice that. Why? Because the 3,000 period average of Apple is probably, like, $50. So if I undo the scale price chart only, now you can see that it's scaling everything, the price moving average, the regular price, whatever else it is. So that's sort of what's happening,
gotcha.
Why you have to do the scale price chart only, and then it's only going to scale the price, and, you know, if something else happens to overlap with that, whatever it is, then it will come back into the picture. So that's a good tip for that. So the dynamic levels, to answer your question, I think that was Lone Star. Basically, when I said that you have to pick the appropriate peak, or the appropriate level to determine the max imbalance, and that's what you're using as the most relevant, that occurs over a certain time frame. So if you're estimating in this area and you say, I only want to know 5 days, well, it's going to find that level for 5 days. That might be here, let's just say. If you're saying I want to look for, you know, a month or 5 weeks, that might be back over here. So a little bit, it's up to you to determine what it is that you want to look at. So if you're looking at a very short range, then you could say, well, here's one support, here's the next support. So if it goes below this line, it'll probably target the next one. That makes sense. Or you could also just say, well, here it is flirting with this support. If it can reverse back above this support, then it's a good level and I'll trade off of it. So there's a couple of ways to use that. And really, the interpretation is not all that different from traditional, you know, trend lines or whatever. I just think that mine are a better
application of the concept. I have a minor issue with this dynamic levels, which is because you say it should be set to at least 5 times your chart time frame, then when I set it to that, it's great. But as soon as I change my chart time frame, I need to go back into that SMR dynamic levels and adjust that.
Exactly. And that is the...
I'd like you to be able to change it so that I can just put in the ratio and it automatically figures it out based on the ratio
that
I type in.
That is a good suggestion, and I will definitely implement that when I release the next update to these indicators. That is something that other people have told me. And you know what? Actually, it's a good idea because I like the concept of just doing the ratio and then everything changes automatically. So I agree with you there. So just to sort of show how this would be going, if you wanted to look at 1, 2, 3 day, you know, ratio, you put the 3D in there, back on, then that's what it's going to be telling you. It's telling you that the last 3 day relationship where there was that imbalance was right here. It hasn't happened yet, and you can see, you know, what you want to see about that. So when I said I suggest at least 5 times, that's just because the amount of signals here is less effective than if you were to do, well, we're on daily, so 5 times would be 5 day. And, you know, here is a level, or whatever. Or you could do 10 day. So I recommend at least 5 times for that reason. I think that's a better use of finding support and resistance. So it's they're like guide markers, you know. So this right here is here forever. When we get priced down here, you could say, gee, it's really near a support. We might find some support there, you know. And the same thing over here, you'd say, well, it's inching up towards this resistance. It could break through, but we'll see if we can start to get a reversal. And maybe here's a time where you throw on the bar to bar down and you trade the first bar to bar down away from the level, and that's a trade. So that's, you know, there's really, the tools here are very sufficient to build an entire trading plan out of. I have some ideas, but certainly I haven't thought of them all. Same thing, like if this was a resistance, right, and now we're getting a support over here, you know what they say about you're above the resistance, it turns into a support, and we're getting a support. You could very easily justify why you would buy off this. Or if here's the first bar to bar down, you say, I want to enter on the next bar to bar up, and that's right here off of this support, right? That makes sense too. So there's lots of ways to look at this and sort of combine the concepts to get, you know, good entries and exits. But let's go intraday really quick.
The width thing, is that just how many dots it prints?
Yes. That's the time period that it's looking at, because what it's doing is by saying, I want to find 10-day relationships, and it's going to plot from the moment where it starts over the course of the 10 days. And while a sequence is in development... Sure, go ahead.
I just see that some series of dots are longer than others. What does that mean?
They shouldn't be. They should all be 10.
Well, I've got it set to 3 now. Is that because I've got it set to 3? I should set it to 10.
No. It should still be the same.
See, I'm looking at a 5-minute chart now, and I've got it set to 30. which is 6 times 5 minutes.
Right.
And my width is 33.
Oh. Sorry, I misunderstood. The width just changes the size of the dots.
Not how many they are.
Yeah, this is, when you said width, I thought you meant length of the dots, and that's relative to the multiple of this to this. So you'll see 5 times 6 is 30, so you get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 dots. So what I would suggest is to extend the dots. Well, my trading view has frozen. Well, I might have to do something about that. It appears my trading view dialog box is frozen. So here, let me talk behind the box. What you want to do is look for untouched previous levels and just previous levels in general. So you got, here's a resistance.
Has he been disconnected? No, he's just got a problem with his trading view, I think.
Alright. Yeah. Alright, so I think a great application of this is to look for past levels that are as of yet untouched. So here's a level. It completed. The first time you can get very close to that level, I would consider that a touch. So if we go to Bitcoin... and we zoom out, what do we see, you know, right here? Here's the resistance level, right? So as we get a reversal, and I think if we turn on the trends, just to jump into this, that was the confirmed reversal day. So yeah, here's the confirmed reversal day. What's a good target for this confirmed reversal, at least at the outset? 400, because you think it can tag the last level. I always suggest that that's a good way to view this. So it does tag that level. So in the future, can we use this level? Yes. But what is a better target? The untagged level. So the next time we would want to use this one, and you can see this one has not been hit, so this is an untagged level. I hope that concept makes sense in that here we have a level, so when we have a reason to believe there's a retracement, you think that it's going to hit this last level. Same thing with down here. Does end up happening, more or less. So now, if we get another retracement, where would we target? Well, we would target the next untouched level, if that develops. We certainly can target the last untouched level, but if we get above here, then you're going to really want to target this untouched level, because it hasn't been hit yet. So you can see we're starting to build the support. And unexpectedly, I mean, I don't think that there's any way I could claim that I thought that would happen in 3 days, but over time you would expect this to get re-tagged, and it did, so that's good. If we begin to decline from here, what level do you think I expect us to hit? Don't, then this one will just stay. So in a big trend, you can see that there are levels that do not get re-tagged. It's not a guarantee, but it is a great target for when you begin to get that reversal. So if we reverse from here, what's a good target? This is a good target. If we begin to rally some more, what's a good target? Well, obviously first this one, and then next this one. So that is another good use. Aside from just saying, oh, we're at support, I'm going to trade off support, using it as a target-based approach is useful. And as you scroll farther back in time, you can see that the concept of hit versus unhit, generally good at determining where things are getting better or worse. You know, sometimes you might get like this, where you have to use a little bit of like a guesstimation factor. You don't know that this is going to be the absolute low at the time, but it ends up being close. You know, I wish I could make it more exact, but that just is what it is. So you're up here and you're saying, well, we're near this target. If I got long over here, this might not be a bad place to take some off. And, they're like zones. So here you can see we went above the zone, came back in. Well, you know, that's life. But this was a reasonably good idea of a level that was important. And this would have been the next level. So, you know, as you're finding where price is going to go based on a trend, you could say, well, this is the target. Or as trend is coming down, you know, so when you watch that happen, you'll see it happen more and more, and you'll begin to, you know, kind of get used to the idea that rare in like the complete aggregate for targets not to get rehit. You know, obviously you have some up here and some right here due to the way this has trended, but generally speaking, especially if you sort in the time frame, you know, on a 4-day, let's just, you know, randomly, I would say the significant majority of targets are rehit, even if on a very short-term basis. Like, there's a rehit, there's a rehit, this one did not get hit, this one did not get hit, this one got rehit, this one got rehit. So that's another way of sort of looking at what you're doing. And last thing I'll say about that, maybe not the last thing, but I added the width so you could add multiple iterations. So if we have a 5-day at 2, then we add, you know, 4 more. You do 5-day at 2, and then 6-day, 3, 7-day, 4, whatever. So you can sort of see, well, man, there's a confluence here, or you could say this is redundant. I want to do 5 and 21. And, you know, how about 8 weeks? We'll do 8 weeks for the big one. You can see it defaults to 1 month.
Yeah, that's really cool. I like that.
So yeah, it's very user-friendly, except for the fact that you have to manually go in and change, do some math. But in terms of seeing how you want to see your time frame, it's pretty neat. And, you know, I actually remember all the way back last week when we were looking at this as the first confirmed reversal, what a move that ended up being. My first target for this was 359. My second one was 393. So those were good targets because, you know, realistically, it's foolish to sit here and say, oh, yeah, you know, got long here. I was totally expecting a $110 move. But you expected some upside based on what this was saying. You say, okay, we got confirmed reversal. Here's target number one right at 355. Got a couple right here, 387. So if you sort of massage the time frame a little bit and you go from 5 to 7 day, well, you can see that they moved around a little bit. That makes sense because you're now looking for support resistance over a different period, which is why for some people they might want to do 4, 5, 6, 7, because that kind of, maybe they could say, well, this one, that's sort of, you know, not material, but here we got both of them in the same spot, that has to be a more important one. You could make that inference.
Does it work well on the lower time frames, like on a 1 minute chart?
Yeah. Oh, so, you know, I guess we can jump to that.
Okay, coin's breaking out.
I would not use
I
would not use the trends on Bitcoin on anything less than a 15-minute chart because of the liquidity. If you see this, keep in mind that my program is sequencing highs and lows. So when there's no data and then the huge bar because of a liquidity issue, it messes it up. So if we add trends to this, it just, I mean, I guess it's not too bad, but it's hard to manage. So what I would suggest for you guys, if you're looking like really at a 1 minute time frame, is to at least switch to the Heike and Ashi bars. That is going to clean it up somewhat, or, you know, move to a higher time frame. I just wanted to throw that out there because it's designed to be fast. There's always a compromise between how much relevance you give each movement versus do I want to catch these big pretty trends. So I did my best, you know, and if you look, it's like it's still got confirmed reversal down here, right here, right here, right here. It's not all bad for the 1 minute, but certainly if you're looking at it on candlesticks, I don't know personally how I would make best use of this. It's too much, but that's, you know, to each his own. So go with the dynamic levels. 100% you can use the dynamic levels on this time frame. Now you're going to have to make them real small. We got 1 minute charts, so we could do 5. You know? And there they are. We make that bigger.
Yeah. I'm starting to freak out because I want to buy now.
Yeah, well, you know what? So like what this software could help you identify in theory, this is like the main value proposition. If I could distill everything I'm talking about into one concept, it's that all things equal, it's better to buy here on the confirmed reversal, better to buy here on the first green bar than it is to buy up here. So if you were buying 10 Bitcoin, hypothetically, and you were able to buy right here at 387 instead of 389, you saved 2 Bitcoin times 10. That was what you saved in your cost basis. Hopefully, that is what justifies the cost of the subscription. So I think for some people, they say, oh, look, it's green. I'm going to bet green. Oh, look, it's red. I'm going to bet red. Green, red, green, red. Personally, that approach is not for me. I don't think it's a magical trading robot. I think it's very good at identifying price relationships. So when you overlap a little bit of, you know, what is the context here? What do the other time frames say? And then you apply sort of like, well, we've been consolidating and I want to buy this breakout. That is where hopefully you can get the best execution. And that is hopefully where the cost is most justified. Because using this as the buy-sell robot, I've back-tested it. It is profitable, but it's not exactly a pretty ride, because what will end up happening is you'll get, you know, short right here for 2 bars, stopped out at a small loss. Long right here for 5 bars, stopped out at a small loss. Short right here for a couple bars, stopped out basically break even. Oh, here, now you get a big trend that makes you all your money. And now you get a big trend that makes you all your money. So if you do that on like a ratio basis, what ends up happening is that like 70% of the trades are some combination of tiny loss, break even, and then 30% of the trades are the big winners where, you know, you're in the trend the whole way. But for most people, they don't have the patience or the stomach to do that. They're not going to see, you know, trend up, trend down, trend up, trend down, trend up, and go, well, that's pretty good. They're just going to see, like, trend down, trend up, trend down, and go, screw this, it's not working. So can it be traded like a blind robot? Yeah, but I don't think that's the best approach. That's just my 2 cents on that.
Yeah. So
going back to the dynamic levels and the lower time frame.
I'm actually right now using it and looking at OKCoin on the 1 minute chart. And I don't know what to do.
Well, let's look at that. Let's go see what it says. Yeah, you know, I wouldn't know what to do with this either. So what can we surmise? Well,
you're looking at Hubi.
What are you looking at? Oh, okay. Like this? OKCoin.
Yeah. No, not dollar. CNY. Type in BTC CNY.
Oh, okay. On OKCoin. Yeah, that's actually much more liquid. That's better. That's certainly better. You know, it's still a little fast for my taste, but yeah. So what are we looking at here? Well, basically price is neutral. Not sure what else to say. I don't see necessarily a trade at this particular moment.
Yeah. Okay, but now that it's actually happening, can you tell me what the gray bar is meaning?
Yeah, gray bar means the trend is neutral. So I break it down into like price states, or price conditions, excuse me, and price states. So there's only 3 conditions, which is price is either trending up, it's either trending down, or it's neutral, which means there's no definable sequence to define the trend. That's it. Those three only. Then you can add the overlap to say, well, that's the condition. What is the state? And that is an individual bar basis. And that's where we can get a pivot that hopefully leads to some direction, or a reversal that hopefully leads to some direction. There's been a little bit of confusion about the way I originally annotated these. The pivot with the P on top is the bear bias. The pivot with the P on the bottom is a bull bias. And for the most part, you know, imaginary quotations around the most part, for the most part, that relationship holds true. But the most important thing is that it is the pivot, not that it has a bias. The way that I did a bias was just to see which direction this bar closed. This bar closes open higher than closed. It has a bear bias. That's it. That's as simple as that logic is. So that's just to give it a bias. But the important thing is that it's the pivot. So the way that you treat the pivot is you trade around the pivot. You look and say that's the high of the pivot.
Which one are you looking at?
What about the blue bar? Is that a pivot? Pivot bar you're talking about, the blue bar?
Anything that is a pivot bar will be labeled with an actual P as a pivot bar. But you can definitely think of the blues as a type of pivot. What the blue is saying is basically price is trying to reverse from a downtrend. So pay attention. That's essentially what the blue means. So the blue is like, you know, here's green, here's downtrend, downtrend, downtrend. Here it says, hey, it's trying to reverse, pay attention. If it does successfully complete the reversal sequence, it will plot an O. And if the sequence fails, it will plot an X. So what I do is, since I know that this is essentially the basis point for starting the reversal, I use the blue as the initial stop on the reversal. And if I get an X, then I move my stop up. So in this particular instance, you can see it was the same thing. This case, I don't know if that went below this tick, but let's just say it didn't. You would use the stop of the X. That's just to help me. So let's look at a more concrete example of that. I know there's one on the just regular S&P. So if we come over here, remnants of another lesson. Here's the reversal. Here's the indication that the reversal is going to fail. So this right here might be our initial stop on this reversal. Let's say that represents $100. When we get the X, then we can move our stop up to underneath the X by, let's say, you know, plus or minus $5, since we're talking about 100, not $5, but, you know, 50 cents or whatever. So what I effectively did is I cut my risk more than in half. If this was $100, this is probably $30 or $40 with the same position size, and then it doesn't, you know, that trade worked. So you come over here and you go, okay, well, that's my initial stop underneath the blue bar low. Here's my entry on the reversal. Oh, shucks, we get this X. Well, now I can move my stop up to underneath the X, and I cut my risk in half for what ended up being a losing trade. We get stopped out right here. We get the pivot bar. Might have been hard to trade that pivot because of the gap, but, you know, there it was. Price moved lower. So if you look at the reversals, drag this bar over here, same thing. Here's the confirmed reversal. Here is the low. So that's my initial. You can see at the X, I at least took a little bit of risk off the table. You know, not much. Didn't go below, stayed in the trade.
Can you slow down a bit, please?
Yeah, sure. I'm sorry if I was speaking too fast. So essentially, the way that I designed this is that when I get long on a reversal, I'm setting my initial stop underneath the bar low. And when I get an X, that's basically saying, hey, this reversal sequence looks like it's going to fail now. It's sort of like a warning that the price is not doing what I've expected it to do in the program. If you remember from earlier, I described how I did reverse engineered fingerprints of all the price behavior, saying, well, in theory, you know, I want to sell up here. In theory, I want to buy down here. So what is the best fit of conditions that will create the relationship of this being shown at this time? So when the relationship changes from what it's supposed to have from this point, that's why we would get the X. So not every reversal will have an X, but the ones that are likely to fail quickly will. So if you look at this from like a theoretical, what does it mean to an actual, I'm going to trade this, what does it mean? When you see the O, that's where you would enter on the premise of this being the reversal. So I think it makes sense to put your stop underneath the blue bar low. And this right here represents your risk size. So if you have a, you know, $100 account and you bet $1, this would be the $1. So when later on you get this X, by moving up your stop, now instead of risking a dollar, you might only be risking what looks like, let's say, 50 cents. So yeah, the trade did not work, but you lost 50 cents instead of a dollar. That's better in my mind. Yeah. So that will increase the overall accuracy, because sometimes these reversals are, you know, uncanny, and you get like dozens in a row that are like, this one doesn't count because I wouldn't take something into earnings. But, you know, here was a great reversal, right? Here was a great reversal. You go back in time. That was a good reversal. This reversal, same thing. I'm not going to count this reversal as being a catastrophic failure because, you know, you shouldn't take a trade based on a technical signal 5 days into earnings. This one was a failure, though. This one was a failure. This one was great. So what makes these more or less profitable? Well, you should be using about the same size on your trades. So this right here, going from where I would enter down to the stop, this is $100. This right here, if this is what you were going to trade, this is also $100. That's very important that you keep your risk size the same across strategy. So if you look at the actual numbers here, you can see that the close of this bar was 74.82 and the low of this bar was 73.38. So what's 74.82 minus 73.38? That's $1.40 or something, 44 cents. So $1.44 divided by, or no, the other way around, 100 divided by $1.44 is something like 70. So you would be long 70 shares here with $100 of risk. That was a great risk reward because, you know, if you had 70 shares up to 79, that's 5 points, that's $350. This right here is the same $100. You'd be looking at the close of 81, the low of 77 and change. So now you have about $3.50 in space. So right here where you were long 70 shares, here you'd be long like 33 shares to get the same dollar percentage. So how does this relate to the X? Well, when you see the X and you move your stop up, now that same $100, you're only risking, let's call that $40 with this slippage. And same thing over here. This would represent higher $100, see the X, you can move your stop up. Well, now that $100 has turned into $30. So we've got, you know, $300 gain, $50 loss, $30 loss. You basically got two trades for less than the price of one risk because of the X. That right there is the value of the X. Sometimes
I need to study that more. Like all of this stuff that you're doing where you're drawing a rectangle and measuring your risk reward and how big your trade size is going to be, working out a plan like that, I don't know any of that.
Okay, well, that's going to be a good lesson for you because that right there is literally the nuts and bolts of profitable trading. All of this is to help you find the structure to do those calculations with. That right there is the math. And if you look at, that's not quite right, but expectancy. Oh, that's pretty funny. This is so key. This is like what you need to be focusing on as much as anything else. Essentially, what you're doing is you're multiplying the expectancy of a winner times the winning size minus the expectancy of a loser and the losing size.
Wow. Can you quickly tell me what's going on OKCoin right now with the trends?
That's the right one, right?
Yeah. Okay. No. CNY. BTCCN.
Shoot. On what time frame? 1 minute again?
Yeah. I'm still watching that.
Okay, well, we had a nice pop. This yellow means basically you can treat it as an uptrend. The actual meaning is a breakout. So what I did is I created a distinction where if you have more than three bars of a color and then in one single bar it changes color, I mean from green to red or from red to green, then you get either a yellow or a purple. So why is this purple and not red? It's not red because we had more than three bars in a row of green, and then in one single bar, it turned red. So just as sort of a notation, I made that purple. Why is this not green? Because we had more than three bars of row in a row of red, and then in one bar,
yeah, green. It's so, like a super bar.
Exactly. Now, you know what's interesting about this is I backtested this as well.
So purple ones are down ones, and the yellow ones are up ones.
Exactly. Correct. I backtested this. The purple ones have sort of an interesting feature about them. They're like one of the least effective signals off the bat, funnily enough. So 75% of the time, you will get some price action below the purple. Of course, this is very marginal, but for the purpose of the test, it validated it. There was some price action below the purple. But 25% of the time, the purple marks the exact low to the candle. And why might that occur? My theory on that is that the idea behind the purple is that you have a strong trend, at least three bars of green means some type of strong trend, and then one single bar that changes to red, in effect, that's almost like everyone getting stop run, you know, below this level, let's say.
Yeah.
And it's just like whoosh, and then it goes right back up. So in this case, for the purpose of a mathematical backtest, this purple would have worked because price did trade below the purple. But I would, based on that statistic, when I see a purple, I don't like rush to go short that. That's just, you know, again, my view on that. There's a lot of signals in here that I personally never trade.
Yeah,
but added them for informational purpose. So okay. I can go, okay, well, this is happening. You know, when you see people posting, you know, we could probably go tease them right now, which I won't do. But when you see someone and it's like, oh, well, this is happening and this is happening and this is happening, even if I'm not going to trade it, I like to say, no, actually, in fact, the relationship 100% here is bearish because this candle is red. And if it changes the very next candle, well, that's what you do when you're testing a hypothesis. Take in new data and you use that new data to form a new conclusion. So the market is pretty much always a hypothesis test of your opinion or your assertion. And that's what you're affecting when you trade is you say, you know, it takes 1 second to click a mouse. There's something like 75,000 seconds in a given day and 23,000 seconds in a trading day. So how many times are you going to click your mouse in all those seconds? By clicking the mouse, what you are effectively telling the universe is, universe, I believe out of all of the possible seconds, past, present, and future, that this second right here, this one, is the best one to click my mouse. So that's a pretty powerful statement. So
yeah.
Given that you can click your mouse so many times and what you're basically telling the universe, it amounts to a hypothesis test of here's what I assert the relationship is and here's what I assert the outcome will be. And that's why even if you're not trading this reversal, this X, this green, this pivot, you can pick and choose, and that can sort of overlap with how you are viewing the market at a given moment. But really, it's it can be just as useful for informational purposes is what I'm trying to get at than anything in trading sometimes, you know. So I like to know that this relationship is happening even if in reality I did not trade this pivot down, and also I did not look to short after this red. One common trick to get more conservative is if you see a signal, any signal, and you wait for price movement outside of that signal, that can be a safer entry. The 1 minute is really hard. I really don't recommend looking at the 1 minute, but you know, like just to look at like a couple of the signals in here in this chop area that weren't great, admittedly. Here you have a red bar, here price moved outside of the red bar. I like that as a short, considering you don't know what's coming next, more than perhaps here's the first green bar and price never moved outside of that green bar. So you can kind of add another layer
you
of
mean
sort of security.
The fact that it didn't have a wick or something.
Not even the wick, just if you like think about kind of the bar-to-bar concept. If in fact this big uptrend is going to happen, or I'm defining it as big, if in fact this will happen, then we know that this very first green bar is the first bar of the uptrend. So you can reverse engineer what will happen in that if this happens, this has to be bar number one. This is the best entry. So if this is bar number one, and also if this happens, then what should happen next? Well, price should go above where bar number one was, right? Because effectively, that's what you're trying to pinpoint here.
Yeah.
So if you see this very first green bar, you go, aha, what do I know? Out of all things equal, this is the first bar of a potential uptrend. So if, in fact, the future holds for us an uptrend, this would be the ideal entry. But I don't want to get into a false uptrend So I will increase my odds by setting a buy order above this bar on the premise that if in fact the uptrend were to happen, that it will fill my order with the market. So by doing that, if you were to apply that same logic, let's say over here, you never got filled. So there was no trade. So this wasn't, you know, like you got duped here. Same thing over here.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen is you might delay your entry a little bit. But now if you look at, you're doing this like the robot, like I said, where you're buying here and you're selling here and you're buying here and you're selling here. And now you've had a bunch of losing trades in a row and you're waiting for that bigger trend to bail you out, which is what will happen if you do strict robotic trading like this. At least now it's like, well, this trade you never even took. This trade you never even took. This trade you never even took. Right? So now what would have ended up happening is this trade you actually would have taken and gotten stopped out, and then this trade you actually would have taken and got stopped out. So yeah, it's still sort of going to be a very short-term method, but you spared yourself a little bit. Same thing with over here. So if you're going to adopt an approach like that, I would recommend doing that. You say, look, if in fact this is going to be a big downtrend, the market will fill my order as it moves down. And you could apply some logic like that over here. So it's not going to delay you too much, while at the same time at least hoping that you get into better, you know, scenarios with that, right?
Yeah.
Human in your chamber is recording.
So just one more example, since I just happened to see this. Here we have a bearish pivot, but remember, it's not that it's a bearish pivot as much as it's the high-low zone of that bar is the pivot level that you want to watch. And what to do about this wick, honestly, I don't know. You know, you could either just say it's above it, I'm buying right now. You could wait till the bar closes. That's a little bit sort of a personal risk tolerance technique. And I'll just overlap that with, you know, nothing can be perfect all of the time. But generally what you're saying is we expect the bias to be down, but this is the relevant zone. So if you saw this reversal right here, let's use our squares again. Here's the reversal. Here's where we would put our initial stop. Uh-oh, we got an X. So now this is our initial stop, and we can move the risk up to the X bar low.
I don't see the X. Where's the X?
Right here. There's the reversal, and there's the X. So we got the reversal, right? So, like, this is how you kind of build a narrative. You say, here's the P bar. I know that this bar's high and low is the relevant range. Let's see what happens. Yeah. Boom, boom. Oh, we're getting a reversal. It's inside the P bar. I want to take this reversal. It's inside the P bar. You know, maybe this will break up outside of the range. I'm going to go long this reversal. That's what I have decided now. So my initial stop would be underneath the blue bar low to the confirmed reversal close. There's my $100.
Whoa. There's action going on right now on KuCoin.
Well, let me finish this really quick and then I'll jump over there. So you see the X bar. You can move your stop up to the X bar low. So now our risk goes from $100 total risk to, let's say, 60, maybe. Don't get stopped out.
I see.
And then as the price continues to move up, now you can say, oh, well, look, it's breaking above this P level convincingly. So that was a good entry. And now your cost basis is down here. Price is going up here. You got another P level. Say, well, what do I know? I know that the bias is bearish, but really what I want to look at is this high-low range. So let's see what that is doing. Price continues to go on. So now what has ended up happening? Was this a huge money-making trade? No. You know, where did you get in? You got in at 2341. It's at 2361. But you were able to adjust your risk dynamically. You cut your risk almost in half. You got some profit out of it. And just using hindsight, you can see that this was a good entry for what ended up happening. And, you know, maybe you get stopped out over here. Maybe you set your stop out down here.
So where do you initially set your stop? On the beginning of the full length of the reversal bar?
Under the blue bar low.
Yeah. I see.
So to use that same math, if we're looking at 2341, let's say 2342, I'm going to round up, and then the low of this bar is 2327, that is 15 points. So what you would do is
100. Wait, can I just want to do it on my chart at the same time.
Sure. do this better.
Human in your chamber stopped recording. Human left your chamber.
So where do you get that box tool?
Human joined.
Which one?
Chamber.
The one that's right here or this one?
Yeah, that one there.
Yeah. Click on human left your chamber. It looks like a brush and then you just pick rectangle.
Oh, that right, yeah. Okay. So you draw it there.
And then when you click on this, you can click the wheel and do, you know, background, whatever.
Yeah. Wow, my chart's lagging big time.
Human left your
chamber. Did you guys catch that? How it went from P to blue? Maybe let's just keep watching this for a second.
Oh, on the... yeah.
What I want to show you is that while the bar is forming, anything can happen. If this price reverses and comes back down here, the whole thing's going to turn red. If, you know, it rocket ships up here, it might turn yellow. So I caution you, see, that now it's doing a P bar, doing the different... Yeah. It's very risky to enter intra-bar. Because when you're looking at this with hindsight to say, well, here was a really good red downtrend, here was an okay green uptrend, and here were some of those other things where we're talking about the entry and exit, that's all on completed bar basis. So this bar you can see has 3 minutes left till closing. If you right-click here and do show countdown, you'll be able to see the amount of time till bar close.
Yeah, I've got that.
Once this gets down to 30 seconds, you know, 20 seconds, that is when you can begin to look to execute your order, most likely. It's really not safest until it's done and done. So if you're saying, okay, you know what, here's a P bar, what have we learned? We've learned that this is the relevant range. What am I going to do? Well, you know, I'm bearish, so I'm going to bet against this P bar. I'm talking hypothetically here because I haven't really evaluated what's going on yet. Then you'd say, here's where my order... Oh, look, did you see how the P bar switched? Before the P was down here, now the P's up here?
Yeah.
Whatever. It's still a P bar. It's in development. This is what we're looking at. So, then now you see what has happened. That's why you don't want to jump the gun, because now it's red. It can easily come back here and be a P again. So that is a very illustrative example of it's taking new data in real time and forming a relationship, but you're not going to want to execute until this is almost done. And now you can see that we actually have to move our low because price did make a new low in that little, you know, blip. So right here, there is no P bar. We're just still in a downtrend right now. So I wouldn't necessarily make a bet after four bars of downtrend or whatever. That's me. I don't see what this is. So we're just watching.
It has to be engulfing the other candle's body or something.
No. Because if you look at this P, it's inside of this entire candle's body.
Yeah.
So no, it's not. It's not.
It's more complex than that.
Yeah, none of this is based on like human engulfing bullish candlesticks or stuff like that. Like, I tried to really bring a unique methodology to the table in terms of how I sequenced price. In fact, I really only know of essentially one or maybe two other indicators out of all of them. I mean, you look at this indicator list, the built-ins, see the people, all the intelligent guys who coded all this stuff. All of these, essentially, they're extremely well done. I'm not saying anything negative, so please don't construe it that way. But they're all doing something that's relatively similar. I really tried to think of something new in terms of how I'm going to order price here, and investigate the relationship between those things to come to some conclusion. So I did put effort into doing that. And you know what? I can show you guys a trick, which is totally off topic from my indicators, but guaranteed will make you the most popular person at any cocktail party, which is you can magically know the value of any stochastic. And hopefully in showing this, you can see how kind of worthless stochastics are, and maybe that will add a little bit of extra value to what's going on here. But let's just finish with this bar. I'll show you the trick. 20 seconds left. now you could place your conditional order to say, you know what, I'm going to try and buy above here. I'm going to try and sell short down here, because now we actually have a relationship on this bar.
Yeah.
Now this is a huge space.
If we're doing I never considered trading off the actual time frame of the candlestick and like watching like that. That's really interesting.
Cool. I'm glad you saw that, because that is a big deal, especially because, you know, I hear people talk about the bots and the programs and all that stuff. What do you think they're looking at? Like, we've created this artificial constraint that is time. We're saying all this price is happening and I'm going to chunk it into these 5-minute bars. What about 4-minute and 45 second bars? Why not those? So we've artificially constrained price into these chunks.
Yeah.
And that is absolutely 100% what a lot of the bots are looking at. So if you watch this enough, you will see price speed up into the last 15 seconds of a candle, precisely because they're trying to front run what the end of the candle is going to do with their orders, because they know that this is how the price action forms using the artificial constraint of time. Otherwise, we would just, you know, use no bars. It would just be seconds and everything would be happening, you know, whatever, in some other fashion. So just to kind of show, if this was your P zone, look how big this space is to represent $100 versus this space to represent $100. So not only do you know that this is going to have a larger position size for the same dollar risk, but that this is harder to trade, because if you look at the size of this, and this is your risk, let's say, all you had to do is get that one candle and you already had 1x risk reward. Pretty good. For this, you're going to have to get, you know, all the way up here. Well, see what's happening. To get 1x risk reward. And 1x risk reward is not great. I mean, you should be shooting for 2x risk reward or 3, ideally. So it's a lot easier to get 3x risk reward from here. You probably got it somewhere down here than it is for this one. So for this reason, maybe in hindsight, we'll look at this P. It will mark an exact low, let's say, for illustration. But it's hard to trade this P right now. You may want to wait for a smaller box or profit opportunity.
Yeah.
So what did I want to show you? Oh, yeah, the joke that is stochastics. So let's come to the SPY, and let's go to one daily chart. The plain English for the math formula of stochastics, tell it to me straight, is percent over range. That's what that means. So when we look at this stochastic, and it's got a 14 length and the 3, which is the smoothing, and the 1, or maybe this is the line and this is the smoothing, something along those lines. Anyways, it's saying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, something like that. So that's the look back, 14. It's saying in this box,
yeah,
from the highest high to the lowest low, where is price right now on a percentage basis of that box? So it's saying it's at 94%. That 94%, which is pretty visually obvious, right? I mean, you can see that just counting with your eyeballs somewhere back 14, it's at 94%. So now let's do the party trick, guaranteed to impress friends, family, and loved ones. Let's go with, let's turn everything off, and let's just go with, Facebook or something. Pick any stock. So what do we have? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Well, if 14, I counted that quickly, but if 14 covers this entire range, what do we know about price right now? Well, right now, it looks like it's in the bottom 20th percentile.
Yeah.
I think that's a fair guess. So let's add the stochastics. Oh. 24 or 33, it says. That's not too bad. And there's a little bit of smoothing here. And if you know the price is now this, if that's the actual 14-day window, that actually looks pretty close to about 1/3 of the chunk. So there we go. Reasonable estimation. Let's do the euro on a 10-minute chart. Oh, well, this is easy because here we can see that drawing the the visual eye box of, let's say, 14 is back here, that is definitely around 20%. It's got to be plus or minus in that vicinity. So let's add the stochastics. Oh, 19. That was a pretty good guess. So when you can see what the indicator is doing, now all of a sudden you're like, holy shit, stochastic isn't telling me anything. Because if I were to say, you know, hey guys, quick, the euro is at 20% of its 14-day trading range, what does that actually even mean? What is the relationship there? Why should that matter?
Yeah.
And that is why this indicator especially kind of makes me chuckle, but that's how all of the indicators work. They're telling you something, but there's no context and there's no relationship. And that was ultimately what I was trying to solve with my program is, yeah, sometimes it will work great. Other times it will stop you out and you'll be frustrated about it. But there's a context. There's a relationship there. That's what it's trying to explore. And that's what these other indicators just simply don't have. And the RSI is certainly better. Oops, that's not right. RSI is better because it's calculating something similar to stochastics, but in a more intelligent way, which is more of like a maximum distance versus the speed time it took to get there, but it still has the same pitfall. And I promise you, if you pick random stocks or random whatevers...
What did you just say? Are you talking about RSI?
Yeah, the calculation for RSI is like the distance with the impact of speed. So it's looking at up-down bars. So like, look at this. Here's one up bar, two up bar, three up bar, four up bar, five up bar, six up bar, seven up bar, one down bar, 8 up bar, 9 bar, 10 up bar, 11 bar, 12 up bar. The way RSI would calculate this is similar to stochastics, and it's saying what is like the percentage in range of the lookback box, but it factors in how much of this was up versus how much of this was down, where the stochastic would not. So this RSI is going to be extremely overbought right here because there are so many up days with only one down day, and the price is at the upper 99th percentile of the box. So when people talk about the indicators recharging, what they're really talking about is we need more up and down bars in a mix mash, because the fact that here's one up, three down, three up, one up, or one down, this is what would slow down the RSI, even though it's still on a percentage basis, you know, in the upper 60, 70th percentile of the lookback box. So that's the difference with RSI over stochastics. If you spend, you don't have to nerd out completely, but if you spend the time like really seeing what the indicators are telling you in plain English as opposed to the picture line, then it becomes a lot more clear what they are doing and more specifically what they aren't doing.
Yeah.
Stochastics is without a doubt the biggest offender. Just because it's like, you know, here we see the stochastics is 70. Okay, great. Fortunately, I was gifted with the gift of sight, and I can see that that's, you know, the 70th percent plus or minus of this. You know, it's just, it doesn't tell me very much. So, anyways, I hope at least that kind of adds another layer of insight into what indicators are doing and how they work.
Yeah, because massively, wow.
If you look, here, I guess, let me move this. Got my screen share thing in the way. Huh. What's going on?
Human left your chamber.
Oh, it's this thing. Okay, so if we click on the script button and you do new, you know, whatever they give you, you can see exactly what they're doing. And that might help you. It's up. Always going to be up.
All right, cool. Gotcha.
And the P can be any direction. Someone asked me if there was a bearish equivalent to this. The closest thing is the orange P. But I did testing on that as well. It's not as simple as just simply reversing the parameters. Price does behave differently going down than going up. So this bearish P, you could almost look at this P right here as being like this blue right here, in that it didn't, you know, but the net effect is the same. Saying like, I want price to go below this P, almost like saying, well, here's the blue. I want price to go above the blue, but it's not quite. So that's another suggestion that Sunny gave me for version 2, is to incorporate, you know, an extra layer for like the bearish equivalent of this, and maybe X bars for that as well. Here's one thing that might be cool for you guys. If you click on the little wheel, the format wheel, you have your inputs.
Human joined your chamber.
And, you know, you can turn the text on and off. So here's P, here's O. Show pivots text. You notice the P's go away. That cleans up the chart for you. And same thing with the O's. Not sure why you would want to do that necessarily, but you can. The other thing is the show early detection. See these squares? That's the early detection.
Yeah.
That's very straightforward. The early detection means that any three of the last four bars are in the same direction. So logically, if three out of four or 75% of something is in the same direction, then perhaps the market's trying to tell you something. So the reason why I call it early detection is because, again, it's not a trading signal. It's for informational purpose, but you get the early detection before the change in, you know, price behavior. So that can happen. The other component of the early detection is here's something you might also want to do. You click on this.
Hang on, I've got a question.
Sure.
When I go to format and I click on style, it shows a really tall window that doesn't even fit on my screen.
This?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there anything up you can do about that?
Yeah. Scroll down. Scroll up. Yeah, you know, that's pickle.
Yeah. Can you, like, change this the way it lays
out? Well, you know what? If you see what I'm doing in the upper right of my screen, I'm zooming in and out of my own browser.
Yeah.
You zoom out enough, then you can click back to inputs. Does that help?
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah, you know, that's something about TradingView's formatting, but hopefully that's not too much of an issue. So see
yeah.
These,
also, those colors, it just says color 0, color 1, color 2.
They won't let me label them. Because of the way I programmed this, I can't label it. So here's what you can do. This is where I was going with this. We'll get there in 1 second. You look at the show early detection. You click it on. You can see the squares go away. But look what happens here. See that diamond that's popping up?
Yeah.
That diamond is in rare circumstances where it says, hey, just want to let you know, FYI, price is extremely close to turning green, so if it goes above here, it's most likely going to be green. And, you know, that's what ends up happening. And there's another, I think I want to say it's SRC, the real estate company I follow. Same thing here. Price turned purple. We also got the diamond down here, so it's like, hey, FYI, just want to let you know, if price goes below my bar low, it's going to turn red. Just heads up. So that's, it's lumped in with the early warning system. Again, it's for informational purposes, you know, just like, you know, that this is a purple breakdown anyways, but now it's just saying, hey, by the way, BTW. So let's go do the style thing, because I think you guys might find some use out of that. So for some people, they might not care about all the stuff that's happening here. So if you go to the style, you can just start changing everything. Colors that you like. So what I'm going to do is change everything except for blue, best pivot, and green. So I'm not going to get any bearish trends labeled on the chart. That was the green. No bearish trends. This is the permeable edition. Nothing ever goes down. So now I will, you know, scroll down, click OK. So now you can see we are left with the pivots. We are left with the confirmed reversals, but now all we're seeing is the green. So whether or not that's good for you or not good for you, that's up to you, but just versatility. And then you say, I want to fix this, but crap, how am I going to remember what's going on? You can just click defaults. And it brings everything back to normal. Let's see. You know what? It looks like if you scroll up or down in this, it will bring you back to the top, even if it's cut off. But maybe that's just because this is located positionally in the right spot. So if it doesn't work, you can just zoom in and out of your browser.
Yeah.
You go to properties. See all this? False, true, true, true.
Yeah.
I personally don't like that, so I uncheck arguments and header.
Yeah.
I would not mess with the scaling. There's no real need to. Another thing that's cool that I didn't realize until, you know, recently, is that the price label will also automatically show the price color. So if you were looking at, you know, something like this, this was a good example. It might be hard to see. Is this blue? Is this pink? Is this whatever? But now you're like, okay, it's red. I see that. So that's pretty cool too.
Yeah, I saw that. So then there's another indicator of yours. I have it.
The momentum peaks, perhaps?
Yeah. I don't know how to interpret that.
Yeah, the momentum peaks is basically... Let's go to the spy for this. The momentum peaks is basically like an oscillator. That is, you know, I'm sure something you guys will be familiar with, since I know a lot of you use stuff like God Mode, things along those lines. So essentially, what it's telling you is this move down is the distance of drawdown from this last high, and this move up is the distance of advance from this low measured up here. So,
looking at it at the right time. I was trying to do it on my own chart.
Are you set up now?
Yeah, I think I've got a different view setting.
Say 65.
I've got them showing histogram. What is yours showing?
Mine is showing a histogram as well.
Yeah, but when you zoom out, then it comes unreadable because there's all that white in between.
You know what? That's another thing with trading view. And here's the thing that's really a shame, is when you first load this indicator for the very first time, it shows up nice looking like this. It's only after you change this period from 65 to, you know, let's say you want to look at like a 40 or a 50. When you change it, that's when it messes it up, which is a shame. So some of you, if you've never loaded this indicator before, you will see that yours looks nice. Ah, shit, my thing froze again. Must be something about all the sharing that is causing TradingView to mess up. But anyways, so let me just talk about this in the background. And then when my thing reloads, we can look in greater detail. So... this is telling you that the percentage, or not the percentage per se, but the move drawdown from here to here is this distance. All right, so let's just do this. So we're looking at peaks and troughs. So what's the measurement of this height to this drawdown? It's right here. What's the measurement of this low to this high? It's right here. So why is this useful? It's useful because it gives you a sense of trading range. And I added in a couple extra things to give you the sort of overbought, oversold view. So whenever price gets really dark, what it basically thinks is that mean reversion is near. It's saying price is getting stretched. It's gone down more than we normally would expect the range, and watch for a mean reversion. So when price is getting stretched, it turns dark. And when price is done with the stretching, you get a square that indicates as such. So if we zoom out again, you can see that this square right here thinks that this is the low end of the range. Well, maybe a little bit. This square right here, it thinks that this is the low end of the range.
See.
This square right here,
human joined your chamber.
It thinks that this is near the high end of the range. So it's not like buy, sell, short type of thing. It's for judgment. If you are buying long because you drew your crayon line above here, 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 and here, and here, and you're doing so at the same time while this is dark green, what it's saying is I don't think there's a lot of meat in this trade. There's not a lot of juice here because of the fact that it's already basically at what it is expecting to be the top of the range. So if you look at those two concepts, you say, here's my magic crayon line. There's my magic crayon line. I'm buying this breakout. It's saying I think there's less juice here because we just came out of a top of the range than if you were to apply that same logic with your crayon line over here, where whether or not the breakout works right away, you're nowhere near the top of the range. You've got more room to run. So when you look at like where these will come in, you know, it's saying it thinks it's near the top of the range there. It thinks it's near the bottom of the range here, and again here, and then again right here. Well, gee, that didn't work out very well. So nothing's perfect. You look at Bitcoin. Bitcoin, you know, has similar type of signals where this is where it thinks it's the bottom of the range. And then, you know, three bars later, it says we think the top of the range is here. And it's only determining this based on this measurement. And if you look at these blue horizontal dots, that's basically just a channel. So when it's getting near the channel or outside of the channel is when it's going to say right here, well, we think that this is the high of the range. And then right here, we think that this might be the low of the range. Well, it wasn't. Right here, we think that this is the high of the range. So it's kind of like a just a visual barometer of where the price is in the range. When you look at this, you notice that the scaling gets all smushed.
Part of the reason. You also have like two colors of green, a light green and a dark green.
Yeah, I will get to that in one moment. This being smushed is because price went from 963 down to 387 at a 66% move. That's a bit much. So if you click on this and you drag, change the scaling manually, and then click out here and drag and sort of fix the view.
Yeah.
So I'm sure some of you know how to do that already, but...
Yeah.
So yeah, the two different shades of green and red, same exact thing, just slightly different time frames. One is very short term and one is longer term. So if we go back to the SPY, all the way out, clear the chart of any drawing tool. So here we're looking at the SPY. We want to sort of develop what is a usual and unusual range for the SPY. Well, now you can begin to see that the usual advance for the SPY is coming in just eyeballing here on the short-term basis. Looks like around 5.75. And the usual decline, as in where are these levels coming in, is coming in around minus 5. So what that helps you realize is that once we get closer to that level, on a usual basis, you know, we are closer to the range low once we start getting down there. You know, close to the range low. Close to the range low. Yeah, sure.
That looks like it must give really good trading signals.
Well, you know what? You know what is great is when you overlap this with a confirmed reversal with, let's say, a dynamic level. Well, you've got all the reason in the world to take a great trade. So I completely agree. You know, if we jump to Bitcoin again, and let's go to like a 5-minute chart. So, you know, forget about the trends for right now, just looking at the general ranges. We'll zoom way out, we'll get a lot of data. And, you know, we can see sort of eyeballing that even in the bigger decline off of this recent bubble, we sort of had like a max, we had like a maximum move, right, around 6.39. You guys see that? And then like the next sort of like sectional breakdown is 3.15. So if we're looking at visually lining up here, 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 we're saying what is this approximately in terms of size? We're getting around 6. So you can see that that kind of marked that low, and that sort of marked that low, and that sort of marked that low in the extreme sense, and this current low. Not everything will be extreme, so what's the less extreme? Well, let's visually eyeball those. Here's the less extreme. Here's the less extreme. You know, here's some less extreme levels. Those are all coming in around, well, let's call it 3. So on like a minor correction, you can see the 3 was a better place to look for the range low. So that's how I use this indicator. I'm looking at ranges, and same thing on the way up. Here's an extreme level. Here's an extreme level. They both came in around 7. The next levels where we're getting some overlap came in around 4.8. And then here, 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 here. What are we getting?
What is that number? 7 and 4.8, what is it? What is it represent?
It's basically a measurement of the percentage advance over the period. So, you know,
it's a percentage number.
Yeah, and it's using a look back and sort of like a minimum. So this is actually very unscientific in a lot of respects. Like I'm sure that some guys out there like Nighthawk or X-Silas could honestly code something very similar to this because the logic is pretty straightforward. We're looking at peaks and troughs. We're looking at distance traveled. This one is a great visual tool for me. It's less of an original concept than, let's say, the sequencing and the bar to bars. So that one is actually pretty pretty non-scientific. And, you know, I might have coded it differently. Perhaps there's another interpretation. I had this in, you know, all this stuff I ported over from another trading system that I was using. So what's great about this is now instead of having to sit at my desktop, I can meet with a client and pull out my little iPad. Well, I guess not the iPad, but, you know, the netbook, and be like, here, look at this, or whatever it might be. So, yeah, you can adjust this look back. Now, I've got to tell you, if you change this number ever, then you're going to lose the beautiful
what histogram. So if I just remove the indicator and add it again, it's messed up for good?
I don't think so. I think it's only if you change this number. Because the original coding...
Okay, so I'll remove it and add it again. Oh, there.
Does it still look nice?
Hang on.
Human entered your chamber.
No, when I zoom in, it's got big gaps.
Well, then that, I'm sorry about that. The reason for that, and I'm going to ask them to fix this because it really bothers me. Go to the property or the style, excuse me. You can see that their histogram notch only goes from 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's it. I forced it manually to go to 8, so fatter bars makes a cleaner picture. But when you reset it, it jumps back to 4, and there's not much you can do about that. You can also change these to lines. See how I've changed the outer ones to lines. You could change the colors. You can turn on and off the markers. So you do have some versatility there in what you do, if you saw that. This line. This line. Okay. And, you know, maybe that's what you're looking at. So it's not volatility, it's not Bollinger Bands, it's simply range expansion and measurement. And here's another thing, if you look at a stock that has been like an enormous winner, when you use this example because I'm familiar with it, we look at Pacira Pharmaceuticals, they have a great product, which is non-opioid analgesic for pain management after surgery. So instead of getting shot up with 8 pounds of morphine, they do a localized injection. And you are not on drugs, and you have zero pain in the spot where you had your shoulder surgery or whatever the case may be. So it's very cool. They, you know, went from $7, let's say 2 years ago, to around 100 as of late. So clearly a good return on investment. And when we're looking at this indicator, which I'm going to reset to the default, since we're doing, you know, average drawdowns, let's again use our visual eyeball technique. Well, you know, here's sort of the plateau, here's the plateau, here's the plateau. They're all lining up in the, let's call it, minus 17, minus 20 range, give or take. So what that's saying is that when this thing pulls back 17 or 20%, that's essentially lower the range. And if it gets too much worse than that, especially as of lately, then perhaps the big picture uptrend is changing. I've done a lot of research on this as well. And this is by certainly no means original research, I just did it for myself to validate, stocks that are really strong and going up a lot don't pull back more than 15 or 20%. So that's a good way to find entries and exits. If you look at MasterCard, another perfect example, I mean, look at MasterCard from, you know, here's like the bear market low in 2009. Here we're looking at 2010. From 2010 all the way up until 2013, it never had more than a, you know, 15%, 18% pullback. Given the volatility that some people expect out of stocks, for something to go from 20 to, you know, 80, 400% return with a 15% pullback along the way is like, you know, you can sleep at night. So it's kind of a cool way of visualizing the strength and weakness of different, you know, assets and groups as time goes on. And, so... this indicator is also fairly straightforward. The bar to bar and the momentum peaks are the most straightforward in their construction. The bar to bar obviously can get more complex in terms of how you trade around it. The trends is without a doubt the most complex, but I guess it also provides you with a lot of information, so that's cool. And the dynamic levels are also relatively straightforward, even though the calculation of them is pretty complex as well. So that, I hope, at least clarifies topically some of what's happening. I know that there's a little bit of a learning curve. One of my main things is that I really hate all of the lines and the zigzags and the crisscrosses and everything. I have, if you go to my website, which there is some documentation on, go to the services, learn more, go to the facts, which there's not a lot of facts in these facts, I apologize. Here's a brochure that I made when I'm, yeah, sure.
Human left your chamber.
Yeah. No. The bar to bar is only looking at the relationship of the last two bars. That's it.
Human joined for the bar to bar?
Just that the relationship is up or the relationship is down. So what that basically is saying is that in a trend, here we've got a trend, right? It's possible you can trade around the bar to bars that go against the trend. So here's a bar to bar up, you could short this bar to bar down. Here's a bar to bar up, you can short this bar to bar down. Here we're clearly in a green trend, right? Well, here's the first bar to bar down, so you can buy the next bar to bar up. That's one way of looking at it. So when people say, I like to trade retracements in a trend, that's one way to do it. The other way to do it is if I turn off the trends, all trends will begin with a bar to bar. So this trend, in hindsight, was pretty strong, right? Where did it begin? It began with a bar to bar. This trend, in hindsight, was pretty strong, right? Where did it begin? It began with a bar to bar in the direction of the trend. So I was explaining this earlier. You can augment your probabilities based on this. So using this example, here's bar to bar up, here's bar to bar up. What is this saying? It's saying there is no relationship on a bar to bar basis that price is moving down yet. No relationship. Aha, we have a new relationship that price is moving down on a bar to bar basis. So it's possible we get only one. It's possible we get only two. But if we're going to get, you know, five, it's going to begin here with the very first one. So, you know, wherever that example was, I'm not sure, something like this. Maybe it was over here. So that's how you can augment your understanding of what price action is doing with the bar to bar. So now you say, okay, we have a new understanding about the probability of price movement from here to here based on the bar to bar, because we know if, in fact, the future holds a large decline, this will be bar one. So being aware of the potential of a large decline on bar one is certainly more valuable than on bar seven, let's say. So it's you're cutting out. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, and whoever was speaking was cutting out, so.
Yeah.
So just really quickly, since I loaded this, here's a brochure that I made as a pitch to other companies for this.
Human joined your chain.
And, you know, you can feel free to read this or whatever you like. Here's basically what I'm trying to avoid. Is to me, you want to avoid this, which is almost comical. But this is straight up in a dead serious chart that I picked from an online forum where the guy was dead serious. He even goes as far as to say, chart does not provide any indication about what's next. Like, yeah, no kidding. You're telling me? So this is like, it's kind of ridiculous, right? But this is like what you're trying to not do. And even when we do my regular chart lack of context, here's with no, you know, no indicator. And we've got my favorite, the oversold stochastics representing the buying opportunity. That candle is right here. You can see it's blue, but there was no confirmation. So essentially what we're trying to do is prevent you from having the lack of context and prevent you from drowning yourself in this, who even knows what's going on over here. So, again, do what you like, you know. There's no one way to skin the cat, but I tried to make it to where you could say, All right, what is the relationship on a bar to bar basis? Okay, we're going up. That means there's no relationship yet that suggests a decline yet. So that's one piece of knowledge. Okay, we've got that down. Now let's see, where are we in terms of this range? I'm curious about that. So we'll load the momentum peaks and we'll say, oh, you know what? We're getting some dark green bars. So even though there's no relationship yet of price going down, I can also surmise that we're closer to the top of what is likely to be a range here than we were here. Okay, maybe that's value add. And then we can
your chamber timed out.
Go like that. And you see how you can begin to like piece together a more accurate picture of what price is actually doing. And that is, okay. Go. We've got all that. What are the trends saying? Well, predictably, the trend is still up because you understand how a trend works. A trend doesn't take into account resistance. It just says, is price going in a certain direction? So resistance might be here, here, and here. Trend doesn't care. Trend saying price is up until it isn't. So we've got a pretty good piece of the puzzle being built now. We say there's no relationship on a bar-to-bar basis that there's any indication of a decline yet. We know that the uptrend is strong, and we also know that we might be near the top of the range. Nearer, I should say. We'll bring up the peaks. So in my opinion, this is a much more straightforward way than saying, oh, well, look, the RSI is ridiculous at this level.
Human disconnected from your chamber.
Which we know it's going to be. Or whatever, you know, RSI 1470. So once we start getting these bar to bars, and we start getting this blue square, which says it officially thinks that the top of the range is near, and maybe let's see if we can get a pivot or something. Okay, well now we have a better rationale for why we think that the market would stop going up that we didn't have over here. So whether this works out to be a fantastic short trade or not is less important to me at this moment than just saying we've done better market analysis and can we form a trade. Pretty sure that this pivot, since we're using this whole chronology here, goes down, then it goes back up, and then it goes down again. But still, you got a better basis for why you could still be bullish versus you should be less bullish, you know? And I think that will help guide your decision because some people out there, I'm positive, they're shorting right here. I wouldn't short right here. Why would you do that? There's no evidence yet that anything's going lower. So you can see that's like, you know, if nothing else, right, this P marked at least a pause that what, you know, so that's how you sort of layer these things together and you can see the context and the relationship that, again, I'm not sure just this line provides. And that's what my tools are attempting to solve, is to say, not only is this happening, but here's the context, here's the relationship, here's how you can use it. You can see, obviously, when they're all overlapped, it gets a little noisy. So I tend to selectively apply bar to bar just to be like, well, what's happening? Okay, I see it. Great. Now, see you later. Yeah, so I hope I'm not sure how long we talked for. I know that my initial meeting with Shane was at 2, and now it's 4. So hopefully there's a lot of stuff to cover. I mean, it's not like trading is a one-stop shop of press this button, smoke a Cuban cigar, and relax. So I hope you can see that there's a lot of depth to these indicators. I put a lot of time and thinking about how to not only apply them from a practical trading standpoint, but what I'm trying to show. And I know that there's going to be tomorrow, you're like, oh, shit. What did that mean again? So feel free to PM me and ask me. I'm more than happy to explain and go through it. And, excellent. That's good. I don't know how many people are going to want to sit through a 2-hour recording of me rambling on. But I very much appreciate that. What I might do is I might edit it and take little snippets. So that way, if you just want to hear about one topic or another topic, then you can, selectively pick what you're looking at. But thank you. I appreciate you doing that.
Hey, Spider.
Yeah, incredibly. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, I really appreciate you saying that. I appreciate that. And I'm also very much looking forward to, you know, continuing to work with you guys in terms of finding different setups and finding out about the market, because like I said, I spent a lot of time at this, but I don't doubt for a minute the insight that's present in this room or with you guys as traders. So I'm very much looking forward to someone coming, hey, I saw this and I did this and that was cool and I went and looked at and it happened again here, here, and here. So I'm thinking this is a good basis for a trade. And then I go, you know what? I never thought of that. That's a great idea. And, you know, great work. So be sure to let me know feedback-wise, good, bad, you know, whatever, about what you see and what you're thinking. And yeah, this was, you know, meant to be sort of like a top-level explanation of what you can do, what you can look for. Certainly we can get into more specifics of, like, here's how I would move my stop. Here's when I would move my stop. Here's what I would do to enter or exit at a later date, because I definitely have some ideas about that as well. And, but yeah, it's, I'm glad to be part of this group. It's cool being able to talk to you guys.
You should just pop in every now and then and say hi. Like, it's open to anyone, so...
Yeah, well, now that I have the TeamSpeak app installed, and if the server number that Shane gave me is the one that you guys regularly use,
yeah,
this certainly
one's
will.
Running 24/7.
Cool, that's very cool.
Yeah, and there's, like, at least, like, 40 people in there all the time.
Nice, that's sweet. That's a good group you guys have built. Yeah, and definitely less noisy than the chat itself, which... sometimes, you know, hard to manage.
Liz, just going to say, Spider, thank you for taking the time to come in and explain the indicators.
Definitely. I am happy to help. I'm happy to share. And, you know, it's like I have a regular job, but I figure that having a side job can't hurt either. So I want to make sure that I don't, you know, waste people's time in the sense that it's like, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to take it seriously, and I want to make sure everyone knows
that
what's happening and all that. So yeah, so it's my pleasure, and I appreciate you guys having me, and I also, you know, very humbled and appreciative of the interest in my work, so that's cool, too.
By the way, guys, we're getting a breakout here.
Should I buy this?
It's scary. It's up to you, man.
Oh, you know what? Here, let me show you guys one more thing. Who's in this room right now? I know Sunny. If Sunny's there, Sunny can attest to this, because I was sending out a handful of PMs, and I do sincerely apologize if you did not get PM. It is nothing personal. I just sent the ones that are at the top of my list. But if we jump to the weekly,
yeah,
what do we see on the weekly? We see, forget about this X for now, we see this confirmed reversal on the weekly. There hasn't been a confirmed reversal. We go to stamp.
Oh yeah, dude. I mean, if you go to if you go on the monthly chart's got a fucking double bottom.
I did not want to do that. So, what I was telling people at the time, which again, maybe this is just complete
luck. Sorry to interrupt, dude. Okay, coin's fucking ripping it.
Nice. We'll jump to that. This reversal, the first one in months, so I do think realistically that this could potentially be the start of a larger move up. So the way to trade that, as you know, is with a stop on the blue bar low.
I'm gonna jump into the other room because I wanna see what's happening with price, guys.
Yeah, for sure. Carry on.
You know what? I'm gonna go as well, but just because I have some other stuff that I need to get done. But anyways, this weekly reversal, that was a big deal, so I'll be watching.
Yeah. If you've noticed, the parabolic star on the weekly is also flicked up as well.
Okay, well that's good too. And here's the daily for the OKCoin. There's P across the board for all of these whatever you're looking at. So what do we know about the P? We got level here, level here. I was really excited yesterday when we were above the P. Thought that was gonna validate it up. It ended up closing back down below. So if you see what happened last time, this P led, we stayed inside this range until here, and that led to a move lower. Hoping that doesn't happen this time, I actually am pretty optimistic that this P is going to at least lead to a retest of up here. So we'll see if that can manifest.
Can you show me a link to the chart, please? I don't have anything up.
In what sense?
I can't see your screen or anything.
Here. Oh, you know what? Stop sharing. I don't know when that happened. But yeah, can you see it?
I didn't have the link.
Oh, okay.
I've just messaged you.
Alright, awesome, man. Alright, yeah, he's just sent me a dude. Thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, I really thought that this daily pattern was a bull flag until we had that slam down yesterday or today. I can't remember. But yeah, I was expecting to rip up and test the upside. Like 2600, 2700 on the Chinese exchanges.
Well, yeah, clearly you can see we're ripping up now. So if we had some dynamic levels to this, we might be able to find a good target for where this can tag. Just eyeballing it looks like somewhere over here, maybe.
My browser's crashed. Fuck. Yeah, I'm quite up on that trade so far. I'm like 30% nice. Up.
Very nice. Alright, well, good stuff. Thank you again for having me. And I'm going to go do some other work now, but I will pop into the TeamSpeak.
Yeah,
probably, let's say, tomorrow.
Yeah, just the next day. Keep a copy of the link, dude, and you're welcome in any time.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys again, and I look forward to chatting more.
Cool, man.
Cheers,
man.
All right. Good luck out there.
Catch you later, man.
Later.